be able to give this year's address, and I can only hope that my questionable oratory skills can do this honour justice. My instructions for this evening are to provide a celebratory reflection on the year. And certainly, there is a whole lot to celebrate about studying law at the University of Sydney. From being taught by the sharpest minds in their respective fields, to meeting incredibly intelligent and motivated fellow students, and sitting with these students on the sunny law lawns at lunchtime, gossiping about life and the law. However, for me to focus on these positive things here tonight would be misleading and deceptive, because it would paint an inaccurate picture of my law school experience. What is left out of most speeches at formal events like these is a realistic reflection on the day-to-day drudgery and frustration and stress of completing a law degree. Yet, it is important to remember and reflect on these difficult experiences in order that we can learn from them. And for me, some of these experiences were as follows. Receiving a 68% in my torts and contracts 2 assignment, and locking myself in the Sydney Law School Society office, vowing to study 20 hours a day until I could remedy that bad mark, and subsequently being woken up at 4 a.m. by the cleaner vacuuming under the table after I'd fallen asleep. Having my skin break out into rashes and having a constant sense of nausea around exam time. My friend's nose spontaneously bleeding from the sheer stress of completing his honours thesis. Comforting one of my friends, who was in tears, outside this very lecture theatre because her grandfather had passed away, and the week before she had turned down an opportunity to fly overseas and see him because she was so worried about failing her upcoming law assessments. It is an oft-cited statistic that more than 30% of law students will experience anxiety or depression at some point while they're at university. Upon entering the legal profession, these mental health problems do not miraculously disappear. In fact, they get worse. There is such an obsession in this law school, and in fact in society in general, on being successful and winning scholarships and prizes and medals, when really what we should be talking about and focusing on is how to achieve our goals in life while also looking after ourselves in a healthy and sustainable way. No doubt it is exciting and fulfilling to receive public affirmation for the things we do. But if we build our identity around these things, as perhaps in the past and even now I'm tempted to do, we're setting ourselves up for disappointment, as inevitably the public accolades will dry up and we'll be left staring at ourselves in the mirror with emptiness and dissatisfaction. But I don't want this speech to be a massive downer. And since I can only speak from my own personal experience, I thought that tonight I would share 2 main factors which have helped me over the last couple of years to stay not only committed to and passionate about studying and practicing in the law, but also, and most importantly, have enabled me to lead a happy and healthy and sustainable life. The first factor was finding balance in life between my career and education, family relationships, social life, and health and well-being. I look back at the first 4 years of my law degree in utter disbelief that I used to think it was okay to eat a packet of Pringles, natural confectionery snakes, and a carton of chocolate milk because I was too busy to cook something healthy for dinner. That I used to scoff openly at those who gently suggested that I exercise and go for a walk once in a while for a study break. That I used to ignore invitations from my family and friends to go out for their birthday because I was too stressed about and making time for my family and friends, that I could approach law school with a positive mind. And it was really only after doing these things that my marks went from all right to university medal standard. The greatest tragedy, I think, would be for you, tonight's prize winners, intelligent, motivated people with so much to offer this world, to remain so focused on that single goal of academic and career success at the expense of all other areas of life, that you die of a heart attack at your desk at the age of 42, perhaps with a lot of money in the bank and a big property portfolio, but with no friends and no family to mourn. It is well worth tonight reflecting on your achievements and the method in which you achieve them, and how in the future you can continue pursuing your goals and dreams in a healthy and sustainable way. The second factor which helped me through the last few years of law school was to rediscover my original motivation for studying law and to formulate career goals and aspirations that were consistent with that motivation. It is almost a joke at law school, delivered with a knowing smirk of derision, that first year students arrive on their first day bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, with optimism in their eyes and a desire to use the law to change the world for the better in their hearts. And that by final year, these very same students inevitably have prestigious jobs at top-tier commercial law firms or investment banks or management consultancies. Not that there is anything inherently wrong with those career pathways, if those pathways are really what you want to do. Rather, the problem is that so many of us who had these original dreams and desires to help people using the law seem to finish law school with a real pessimism about the ability to do this. I read an article a year or so ago by an American law professor, William P. Quigley, titled "Letter to a Law Student Interested in Social Justice." One quote in particular stood out to me and has really helped me to stick to my own career goals and aspirations. He wrote, "For social justice lawyers, the path is more challenging. You have to leave the highway sending you on towards the traditional legal profession. You have to step away from most of the crowd and create a new path, one that will allow you to hold on to your dreams and hopes for being a lawyer of social justice." Having now volunteered and worked in the community legal sector for the last 4 years, and hopefully far into the future, it has become clear to me that there are more reasons now than ever for students interested in a career in social justice to maintain a dogged determination to their goals of using the law to obtain justice for and empower the most vulnerable and disadvantaged members of our society. Without such dogged determination, we will not be able to put pressure on federal and state governments to reverse the 30% cut in funding to community legal centres, which are already so stretched to the limit and which assist thousands of individuals who otherwise will not have the money to obtain legal advice. Without such dogged determination, we will not be able to fight against the many injustices that could be remedied rather than perpetuated by our legal system. Injustices which include the fact that there remains today Indigenous families living as tenants in town camps less than a kilometre from the Darwin CBD in absolute squalor, surrounded by garbage and excrement and broken toilets and lights and doors, because apparently their landlords have no money to fulfil their obligations as landlords. The fact that there are homeless young people with fines exceeding tens and thousands of dollars and facing imprisonment for these fines because police and transport officers do not seem to understand that indeed being homeless and suffering from mental health and drug and alcohol abuse problems probably means that you're not going to have the capacity to buy a train ticket. The fact that there are refugees and asylum seekers being tortured and sexually abused and psychologically destroyed in offshore detention centres, burning themselves to death because they think that's the only viable means of escaping their situation, all under the cover of Australia's national security interests. If indeed you entered law school with a burning optimism about the positive things the law can achieve, I implore you to hold tight to your aspirations and allow them to inform your decision-making and career pathways as a law student and a lawyer. Our system needs intelligent, hard-working people like tonight's prize winners to keep fighting the good fight and to use the law as a tool for social justice rather than a tool of oppression. Before I conclude, I'd like to spend a few minutes expressing my gratitude to the people who have supported me throughout law school and without whom I would never have had the privilege of addressing you all today. To the lecturers and tutors at this great institution, thank you for imparting your enthusiasm and dedication to the law to all of your students. To my employees throughout law school, including Raggy Mather, who is so kindly here tonight, thank you for teaching me how to translate theory into practice and for being such wonderful and patient mentors. To my family, in particular, my dad, grandmother, and brother, thank you for loving me unconditionally and offering the kind of unquestioning support that only family can. To my friends, thank you for being there for me throughout the ups and downs. Honestly, I would have quit law school for med school many years ago. In particular, I'd like to thank my long-suffering study buddy, Nicholas Kondilis, who we must congratulate tonight for winning the Peter Cameron Scholarship to Oxford University. For those who do not know Nicholas, let me tell you this. He is the pure embodiment of the idea that with hard work and humility, you can achieve absolutely anything. Nicholas, to you I say this. I hope that I never, ever again have to stay up until 4 a.m. discussing the intricacies of the implied constitutional freedom of political communication to Victorian anti-protest laws. But if I do have to, there is no person on earth that I'd rather do it with than you. Finally, I'd like to thank the one person who has supported me for my entire life and pretty much would sacrifice anything for me, and who would love me equally whether I was here giving this speech or had just been accused of defamation following a corporation's law exam. And that person is my mother, Karen May. Now, when I was in primary school, my mum began attending university as a mature age student, having never been to university before. And I remember to this day watching her study diligently on the weekends and weeknights while also somehow managing to raise my brother and I as a single parent. And not only did she do a damn good job of that, she also managed to top her course at university. Remember to look after yourself and your friends.